This is the second video in my lab series about how to model a DC motor. In the first video, we introduced mechatronics. Now in this video, we go more in depth into how a Teensy works, which also carries over to Arduino. We're going to talk about the differences between digital read and analog read, digital write and analog write, and we're going to talk more about analog write and how that's pulse width modulation, or PWM, and how we generate that signal. There's a lab portion that accompanies this video, and there's a link up top to it that'll show you how this theory actually applies in the real world.
Started. We're going to kick off today, picking up where we left off yesterday, on Tuesday, talking more about analog versus digital systems and really how we implement it. So, I mean, how many of you remember your stuff from engineering in 97, engineering 10 with Arduino?
Okay.
So that's what I figured out. My goal today is to help clarify some of the things that we did in there and why the numbers were the way they were, and kind of maybe get rid of some misconceptions there. Let's start off with what I asked you to do in MATLAB. So in MATLAB, I asked you to plot a 1 kHz, 2 volt peak-to-peak sine wave with a 1.5 volt DC offset. All right, we've seen that wave over and over again. We're going to keep looking at it. So could you plot this continuously in MATLAB? Did anybody get it to work continuously? That's a good answer. All right, because you had to break it down. All of you figured out that you have A sine omega T plus some offset, and you generated a time signal, and you created your sine wave, which centered somewhere up there. Right, and you basically said that to go from there to there takes 1 millisecond, which is equal to 1 kHz. And 2 volt peaks to peak would be plus or minus one. And if you have a 1.5 volt, that's 1.5 volts there. So go up to 2.5 volts or down to 0.5 volts. Yeah, sine wave like that. Right, so I saw that on here. Where there was some misunderstandings, though, was I asked you to sample it at 20 kilohertz. What do I mean by sampling? What's taking a sample of something? Where have you heard the term sampling before? Never sample anything?
Is it like the time increment that you're taking your sample of?
Okay, so the time increment. So you're saying sampling to time increment. So I said 20 kilohertz, which is a frequency. What's that in time? How do I get from frequency to time? 1/frequency. So 1/20e³. So that would be 20 times per second. So we can say that's 20 samples per millisecond. All right, sorry, not per second, per millisecond. All right, so 20 kilohertz would be 20 samples per millisecond of time. So we said that this is 1 millisecond, which would mean I would have 20 samples along the sine wave here. So I'm talking about sampling frequency. If I had this function generator making a sine wave, and I were to sample it at 20 kilohertz, I would end up with 20 points to represent that sine wave. If I were to sample at 40 kilohertz, I'd have 40 points. My frequency wouldn't be 20 times higher, right? Because I'm sampling that signal. I'm not creating a new signal. Does that make some sense here? So as we're going to start talking about digital versus analog and how we create this discrete function, if I were to sample it, the value would change once per sample. And so we'd end up with this. So some of you ended up plotting something like this. Others of you connected the dots like that and did one of those connect the dot puzzles. Some saw that thing, I think if you Googled, I'm guessing a couple of you Googled like discrete time or sampling time in MATLAB, and they showed this chart with circles like that. That's out of digital signal processing theory. That's usually how they would show sampling theory. So there's different ways to interpret that. But again, what we're looking for is sampling. Make sense? Awesome. So now let's move forward a little bit, and we're going to talk about our friend Arduino. And in this course, we're going to be using something called the Teensy. The TeamC is basically an Arduino on steroids. Arduino costs about, if you buy the real one, $30 for Arduino Uno. That was what was in your starter kit when you took Engineering 10. A TeamC costs $20 and is 10 times, 20 times more powerful. You do a lot more, but the good news is we program it using the Arduino language. So you can do every command you did in Engineering 10, and then there's a whole suite of other commands that you can do to make it more powerful. So we'll introduce some new things. But we talked about digital and analog. So we said a digital signal is a one or a zero, right? Give me an example of something that creates a digital signal. What would create a digital signal?
Switch.
Okay. How would I read a switch into an Arduino? Anybody remember that command? How do I read a switch into an Arduino? Give you a hint. What are we trying to do? We're trying to read or write. I'm trying to read a switch into an Arduino. Am I trying to read it, or am I trying to write to it?
Read it.
Read it?
Read it.
Okay. And what type of signal am I trying to read?
Yes, sir.
Digital. Okay. So I'm trying to do a digital read with some pin, right? And so digital read returns a one or a zero. That command makes sense. How about if I want to turn something on or off? Link something, let's say, right? On, off. On, off. What command would I use for that?
Set it equal to higher low.
Okay, and how would I output that higher low? How would I convert that from code on the Arduino into action? What type of write would I do? Digital write. So I'm not trying to get too complicated here, right? Digital write. Some pin, some value, right? So this value could be on or off, right? That's digital. On, off, on, off. So now let's switch over and start talking about analog. If I wanted to read a sine wave into an Arduino, would that be a digital signal or an analog signal?
Analog, yeah.
It's analog signal. So what command would I use to read that into an Arduino?
Analog read.
Analog read. Okay. Analog read. Some pin. So digital read gives us a 1 or a 0. What does analog read give us? What's the range of values we can get from analog read? What's the lowest thing? Zero? Okay. Yeah, zero. And what's the max?
255.
Is that another number that pops into your head?
127.
127? Any other numbers? What's 255 times 4-ish? 1,023. 0 to 1023. Those seem like arbitrary numbers, right? 0, I mean 0, 0. But where's this 1023 come from? How many numbers are between 0 and 1023?
1024.
That's 1,024 discrete values between those numbers. Does that number seem more familiar? What is that?
A bit.
A bit, okay. 2 to the something. 2 to the 5 is 32. 664, 728, 856, 9512. 2 to the 10. So we call this a 10-bit analog to digital converter, ADC. So that's where that number comes from. Your Arduino has a 10-bit ADC. It just so happens that the TeamC has a 16-bit one, which means that number gets very smaller. So Arduino can read things from 0 to 5 volts. TeamC goes from 0 to 3.3 volts. Now this is what we call 5-volt tolerance for digital. So digitally, it thinks a zero is a zero, 3.3 volts is a one. Arduino thinks a zero is a zero, 5 volts is a one. But the TNC says, look, some things are gonna give me 5 volts, I'm gonna be okay with it if it's digital. But if it's analog, I'm gonna get really pissed off. But where this ADC comes in is if the maximum I could read is 5 volts, the way the analog digital converter works is if I have the full range here, and I have some voltage, let's say that this is 0.012 volts. What we need to do on a computer is convert everything into a series of yes and no questions. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna ask, is it greater than 0.004 volts? No. Is it greater than 0.008? No. Is it greater than 0.012? We'll give it a yes. So we could write that as no, no, yes. And what happens is if we have 1024 different values, we take 5 over 1024, which gives you approximately 0.004 volts. And that's what each step is. So when we say that we have a 10-bit ADC, it means it basically can ask 10 bits worth of questions to figure out what that voltage is. And that's how it's reading it in. And we get a voltage and a value like that. So when we say the TNC has a more accurate ADC, if we had 10 to the 12, well then that would give us 4,096 different values. So when you divide that by 4, our questions become a lot finer. And then you might say, well, why don't we always use a better ADC? Well, what if this signal is supposed to be a nice DC voltage? What if I had a bunch of noise on it like this? Well, if my ADC steps are like this, I wouldn't see that noise. But if I had teeny tiny little steps, my value would fluctuate. So even though I have all this extra resolution, I have to average it out anyway, so it doesn't matter. So what we're trying to drive for in this class is design the experiments. Your boss is gonna ask you to figure this out. You need to justify spending extra money on better sensors or worse sensors. So understanding your noise to help decide whether or not it's worth to get a better sensor. So we left off at analog read. How do we output from analog, right? So we have analog read. If I want to go out, what would my output be? Come on, we have a pattern here. Digital read, digital write, analog read. I hope everybody got analog write. And again, that's a pin and a value. What's the maximum thing you can analog write? Is it 1023? Is it zero? I'll give you a hint, the number is somewhere in here. We shouted out earlier. What was the maximum thing? 255? Does that sound familiar? So you can analog write something from zero to 255. Now, my question is, if we always say, right, people say computers are ones and zeros, right? All they can think is ones and zeros. How can I take a bunch of ones and zeros and a digital thing and have it create an analog output? This is what we're gonna work on today and try to understand. So anybody have any guesses as to how analog write works? So we're going to do this in Arduino math just to make life easy. So we said to the Arduino, what voltage range do we get? Zero is the low, five is the max. So somehow we have to have zero goes to 0 volts, and 255 represents 5 volts. Is there any acronyms that anybody's ever heard for how analog write works? Three-letter acronym. Pulse. With modulation? Has anybody heard of that before? Maybe.
Okay. Well, if not, pulse with modulation. PWM.
Okay, pulse with modulation. Who's heard the term modulation before? Nod if you've heard modulation. I have a couple nods. Where have you heard that before?
Singing? Like orchestra music.
Okay, what do you do in music? How do you?
Everything shifts up higher, so like the key.
Okay.
Increases.
Shifts up higher. Where else have you heard the word modulation in audio? Before there was Pandora, and before everybody had internet radio, how'd you get music in your car? Don't tell me you listen to silence, right? When your phone's broken, what do you listen to? And your CD player's stuck, and your cassette player doesn't work. What do you turn on?
Radio.
Okay, FM radio. What does the M stand for in FM?
Modulation.
Modulation. Everybody know what the F stands for? Somebody's whispering.
Frequency.
How about AM? Amplitude modulation. So we're modulating a song into a signal there. So anybody know the range of hearing for human beings approximately? What's like the maximum frequency you could hear as a human? 20K. 20 kilohertz is the range of human hearing. 20 kilohertz. Okay. And what radio station is B104 in the valley? Give you a hint. 104.
104.
One. And what units? B104 is 104.1 what? Gigawatts? Gigawatts? Hertz? Gigahertz? Kilohertz? Megahertz. Megahertz. So this is 20 e to the third, and this is 104.1 e to the sixth, right? So that's significantly higher frequency. So what we're doing is we're modulating some voice signal, which is somewhere in this range, into this much higher frequency signal. And there's two different ways they do that, right? Either they adjust the amplitude or they adjust the frequency of the signal based on that. So that's modulation. And that's exactly what we're gonna do here, is we're gonna modulate some desired voltage into a pulse width. What do you think of when I say a pulse width? What's a pulse? Draw it in the air, what do you think? Everybody's kind of drawing something like that. Exactly. So we're trying to get some sort of thing here. And the pulse width is our duty cycle, which is a ratio of on to overall time. And we can adjust that width. So sometimes we could be on for longer, sometimes we could be on for shorter, but this fundamental frequency stays the same. And this is our carrier frequency. Just tell this is the carrier frequency. So you tune your radio to the carrier frequency, and that's what we're gonna be looking at here is pulse width modulation. So the way they do that is we have some signal. So let's say I wanted to go and take this nice, right, if I had like, let's say, a whole sine wave, I were to focus just on this little portion here. What I could do is I could break this up into smaller segments, bring this down, and we have some carrier frequency. And what we're gonna do is take what's called a saw wave like this. And so this has some frequency, and this is our PWM frequency. On an Arduino, by default, it's 490 hertz. Anybody, you're musically inclined, what, you know, 490 is pretty similar to what? Like, what's a, like a D or an A? Aren't those around that frequency? Those fundamental waves? So you ever hear things hum or make noise? It's because they're all happening at frequencies that we can hear, right? So if you hear things buzz, it's because maybe your frequency that it's operating at is very similar. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna modulate a pulse train using this voltage signal we want. So what we can do is, again, we're trying to turn everything into a series of questions that are binary. So we can ask, is our desired signal here greater than here? Well, for right now, yes, 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 yes. All of a sudden, now it's less. So what we would do is we would say, yes, no. And then, is my signal greater? Yes, yes, yes. Okay, so now it's for longer. And is it greater? Okay, yes, for longer. And then, is it greater? Okay, yep, for even longer. So now, if we look, the width of this is changing based on a simple yes, no question. And that's how we can generate, using binary logic, a PWM signal. So there's a PWM generator, and this is our desired voltage.
So we can encode. Basically, if I wanted 2.5 volts over 5 volts, and I have 0 to 255, I'd have a PWM val of approximately like 127. If I wanted 5 volts, I'd do 255. Right? And if I wanted 0, it'd be 0. So I could have off, and then if I went halfway, it would be 50-50, and then it could be on for an entire pulse train.
That's what's happening there. So it's taking what you want and encoding it into this signal like this. But I don't want you to just take my word for it. I want you to see this for yourself. And that's what we're going to do today, is we've already started talking about oscilloscopes. Oscilloscopes let us see signals. So what we're going to do is we're going to experiment on the Teensy and actually look at, as we do different PWM values, how it changes and how affecting the PWM frequency and resolution. But if I have this 255, that means there's only 255 different ratios of on to off I could have. That's 8 bits. What if I had a 12-bit resolution and I could have that much finer precision? How does that affect things? And I told you we've been playing around a lot with the same sine wave. So my challenge to you today, at the end of the day, is I want you to take that 1 kilohertz, 2-volt peak-to-peak, 1.5-volt DC, and I want you to make the Teensy output this. And I want to see this on the oscilloscope. Now, some of you are saying to yourselves, I hope, well, he just told me that everything that comes out of analog out looks like this. So how can we convert this to this? Well, when you're at the radio station, they modulate the song into the carrier frequency. What we need to do is demodulate it. So we're going to use what's called a low-pass filter. And you're going to have a resistor, and you're going to have a capacitor, or RC filter. And that RC, there's a circuit for it on there. And what that's going to do is we're going to have a cutoff that basically ignores this high frequency and just tells me what the average is coming out. And that'll allow you to take this PWM and demodulate out the sine wave signal from here and look at the oscilloscope. So on course site is a step-by-step. You want to do each one of those in order, follow through. Inside of each box should be a Teensy and a cable. You can log in, you can use the Arduino software, go through. At the end of the day, there's the challenge. Basically, go through and just do it on the oscilloscope. You could show us, but basically we're here for questions. Works, you're good. Work your way down. I also have multimeters if you want to see, because multimeter is kind of like taking the average. So you have, this will show you the signal. The multimeter could be like an LED or anything else that's looking at the average signal. And we're going to use this going forward. So give it a shot. If you have any questions, let us know.
If you enjoyed this video, please be sure to check out the lab portion. I've also uploaded my course site to my website, mattbilski.com, which has the details on all of the experiments along with all these videos and the files I referenced. Also, please consider subscribing to my YouTube channel to stay updated on projects like this, more mechatronics topics, and my snake-like robot. Thanks, and I hope to hear from you soon.